Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon. Welcome to a very windy day here in Southern California. It's crazy wind out there today. We've got the sun today, no rain, but we've got the wind. So we're inside so we don't get blown away. So welcome and so glad you're here with us. Today, we're gonna do a garden Q&A. So if you've got garden questions, I've got garden answers. So we'll get into that in just a moment. Also pulled some questions from the YouTube videos, got some from Instagram to answer today. So it's gonna be a fun one. And just popped over from the pre-livestream chat. There's a lot of you who are still having cold, snow. It's been crazy weather all over. The Florida people and the Texas people have 75 to 80 degrees, but we're still warming up here in Southern California too. And so glad you're here. Hang in there, you guys. It's got to be warming up and stop snowing soon wherever you're at. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll get these plants outside so we can get out in the garden and start growing some of our own veggies. So let me say hello to those of you that are here in the chat. So glad that you chose to spend part of your Monday with us. Backyard Garden Flow 2021. Hi, Kim and Jerry and everyone. Great to have you here. Lori Malone, great to have you. So glad that you're here. Terry Williams, watching from the coast in Southern California. She said it's 70 and sunny there. No wind, so we'll make sure that we don't send any of the wind down your way. And hopefully it stays that way so you're able to get a lot of your plants out in the garden. I know we have Eric from Smart Pots here and Smart Pots as well on their login. Let's see who else is here. Laura LaMontanaro from Long Island. So I wonder what the weather's like out there, Laura. Hopefully you're warming up and able to get outside in the garden really soon. So if you're new here, I wanna send a special welcome your way. So glad that you're here. A lot of people getting excited about spring garden. Make sure you tell a friend, bring a friend along. It's all about fun here on the Monday Lives. We have a garden topic, but there's tons of gardeners from all over the world at different levels in the chat, able to help you out. Our moderators, Cliff and Nisha, are great gardeners themselves and are always happy to help and answer your questions. So we're here every Monday at noon Pacific time. Cliff and Nisha, the chat opens at 11:30 and then I'm here about 11:45. So welcome and so glad that you're here with us today. So let's jump into some questions from the YouTube videos and we'll kind of go back and forth, answer your questions live. And then I'll answer the questions that I pulled from YouTube and Instagram in between as well. So first off, question from on the transplanting video that we did, I believe it was towards the end of last week, Randy D had a question on that video. So Randy said, I up-potted my peppers and tomatoes 2 weeks ago with thoughts of putting them in the garden this week. We are a good time past our last frost date, but now we're looking at temps possibly in the high down in the high 20s this weekend. How long can I keep them in my garage under grow lights? I think a lot of us are dealing with that right now due to the crazy weather. Normally, I'm gonna grab one of my pepper transplants here. Normally I'm starting to put my peppers out in the garden around the first day of spring. So this year is not quite like that. I did pop a couple out there early this year with the wall of waters. But Randy, you do really wanna be careful not to put them out too soon, especially if you don't have any protection for them. They're definitely not gonna survive temperatures in the 20s. They love the warm weather and temperatures in the 20s are just not good for them. So you can continue to up-pot them if need be. And you know, eventually they definitely will need to go outside, but hopefully within the next 2 to 3 weeks, your temperatures will warm up. For peppers, you really want temperatures at nighttime in the 50s and 60s for optimal growth. And then daytime temperatures, you know, warm 60s, 70s on up to 90s for them to really do well. So definitely keep an eye on it. And if your nights are down in the 20s for sure, but even in the 40s, it's pretty chilly for them. So do wait until those temps get consistently warmer. And, you know, just fingers crossed that you're able to get them out of the garage, out from under the grow lights. before they outgrow their little containers. This will probably, I just up-potted this on Thursday or Friday, could probably do pretty well in here for another 3 to 4 weeks, and then I'd have to up-pot again. So it really just depends on the space that you have, if you have space to continue to up-pot them. But hopefully within a month or so, fingers crossed, you'll be able to get them outside. So if you didn't catch the transplanting video, do make sure you go back and watch that. Super easy to up-pot your plants as long as you have space in the house for larger pots, or you can move them in and out during the, you know, in during the nighttime, back out during the day, and make sure they're fully hardened off before I get them planted out in the garden. But definitely a bigger issue this year for myself anyway than it has been for other years. So Randy, hopefully that tip helped. Thank you so much for commenting and asking a question on that video. Really appreciate it. So let's pop in the chat here, see what other questions you might have, either on transplanting or other garden topics. Let's see, we'll scroll back through here. And Trisha, great question about Tiny Tim. What size pot should a Tiny Tim be planted in? You definitely want to start your Tiny Tim seeds in the smaller seed cells. They just do a better job, you know, if you're planting them in smaller size containers to start with. These little 4-inch cow pots work great for starting tomatoes or peppers or pretty much any kind of seed. And then you can move that into the 1 gallons. For their final home, you want to have them in at least a 5 gallon. A 1 gallon is just a little bit on the small side. You still might get some tomatoes, but you'll definitely get more, and the plant will be able to thrive if you pop them in a 5 gallon. And really, that's perfectly sufficient. You really don't need to go as large as a 10 gallon. A 5 gallon will do just fine. I've got black ones and all the vivid colors over at CaliKimGardeningHome.com. And those are the best little dwarf tomatoes. So productive, and I know you're going to enjoy them. So thank you so much for your question. Really appreciate that. Jeremy has a question about any advice on planting borage and lovage. I've never grown lovage, but I love to grow borage. And it is a very, very easy herb. It's actually an herb to grow. It's also a great plant to bring in the pollinators. If you've never grown borage, it has small little purple star-shaped flowers. The leaves are a little bit prickly. They smell like cucumbers a little bit. And you can start them from seed very easily indoors. They're super, super easy to grow. I would start some either in the cow pots or in the little 6-pack seed cells, whatever you have available to you. And they'll germinate very easily, grow very easily, very quickly. And they love the warm weather. So you can pop them out in the garden. The great thing about borage is that it self-seeds a lot of times year after year. At least it does here in California. So I think I planted some borage years ago, and every year once the weather gets warm enough, it pops out in the garden and the bees absolutely love it. So I actually have borage seeds in my Bring on the Pollinators warm season flower collection. The bees really, really enjoy borage. So I highly encourage you, if you need an easy to grow flower to bring in the pollinators, plant some borage. You're gonna love it. It's also a good kind of filler plant. If you're trying to fill, you know, certain areas with a plant that'll take hot weather really well, that's a great one to grow as well. Okay, Nicole says, yes, Kim, I got my borage seeds from you. I will always have them in my garden. And I know you're going to love it, planting those borage seeds. Okay, Jeremy, great. I'm really happy that you're going to have those in your garden this year. I think you're really going to enjoy it. Okay, let me jump into another transplanting question here, actually. And this one's from Tommy. And Tommy says, are you planning to wait about a week or two to put them in the earth? So he's probably referring to the peppers and tomatoes that I potted up in the transplanting video. Day temps in SoCal won't exceed 70 for at least one more week. And yes, I definitely am planning on waiting. We've had nights still in the 40s and even a couple in the 30s. So unless I was able to put a wall of waters around it or cover it with something, my peppers and tomatoes, it's just not quite ready yet. And also in a lot of places in the garden, my soil is still very, very soggy. We actually have gotten 22 inches of rain so far this year. All of last year, we only got 9 inches. So you can imagine how crazy soggy things are. Definitely drying out. So I'm hoping, fingers crossed, within the next week or two, we'll get them out in the garden. But yes, definitely do wait until the temperatures are right to put them outside, or all of your hard work is going to go down the drain and you'll lose a lot of your transplants. So always, as a gardener, Here's another way you can kind of just think like a gardener. Always be keeping an eye on the temperatures and then plant appropriate plants outside. Now, right now is perfect to get the cool weather seedlings outdoors if you haven't yet. In California, usually we're having much warmer temperatures this year, but we're able to extend the cool weather veggies just a little bit longer. And now they're really thriving with all of the rain as well. The nasturtiums, the cool weather flower are starting to pop out. If you watched our video yesterday, we did a little video on our new April subscription box. You saw Little Shorty out there, and Little Shorty is full of greens right now. Cool weather greens, it's doing beautifully. And all those greens, by the way, were planted from the seeds from our box one of our Grow Your Groceries subscription box. Absolutely thriving. So it was really fun to grow those greens from that box. And I know Patricia said that she's planting her salad greens from the first box in her green stock salad tower this week. So thank you so much, Patricia, for growing with us. And our subscription box for April is now available. So we've got our whole living room here. We had our packing party on Saturday. Our whole living room here is ready of April boxes, ready to ship out. It's a really fun theme for April. Each month the theme is different. Last month was Grow a Salad Station. All the seeds are different seeds than I have in my regular CaliKim seed collections. To give you a little sneak peek, last night we made something. We filmed an instructional video just for subscribers of the box. We made something that those of you that are getting the box this month are gonna see in your instructional video. Your mouth will be watering, I guarantee it. It's something that almost everybody likes. And all the seeds four seeds to put in this particular garden recipe are in the box, so you're gonna love it. So if you haven't got yours, run over right now to CaliKimGardenHome.com. Supplies are limited, they're selling fast, and I know we're gonna sell out again this month. But just to give you a little sneak peek of our seed packets, they're beautifully designed. These are from last month, the four little salad station seeds. But run over and grab your box. You can see the box behind me. Here's another little sneak peek for this month. A little freebie in the box, fun freebie, is a Grow Your Groceries with CaliKim magnet. So we thoughtfully curate everything, so you have entire growing kit in your box, along with some really fun ones. So you can get $5 off with the code APRILSUBBOX. So hopefully you guys are enjoying it, and please let us know how it's going for you. Okay, Peach Redway, can't wait for you to get it either. They start shipping on Friday, so be looking for it in the mail next week. And Smart Pots, thank you very much. We love CaliKim seeds. We've had perfect germination with our Tiny Tim seeds. So they are doing a fun project there over at Smart Pots. So make sure you follow them on Instagram. They're growing all kinds of groceries in their office under little grow lights in 1 gallon or 2 gallon little Smart Pots. So make sure you follow them. They're going to be posting on it. You can grow a ton of groceries in a small space, and they're using all CaliKim seeds and having a great time. Okay, guys, let's jump in here. Alina, let me take a couple more questions from the chat, and we'll answer some questions that were over on Instagram. Okay, let's see here. The wind finally calmed down. My seedlings are getting some sun from my rain. Rain again tomorrow and Wednesday. Yeah, definitely it's been a crazy year for rain this year, hasn't it? And Rory, great to see you on here, Rory. As a filler for garden beds, is straw always pesticide free if I purchase from the garden store? You know what? Can't guarantee that for sure. You may want to ask around to make sure that the straw that you're getting is pesticide free. And then, you know, plan accordingly. I know I get some clean straw from Kevin at Epic Gardening, really enjoy that. The straw bales, definitely ask, that's definitely much cheaper, but you will need to kind of do your research and see, you know, if it's pesticide free or not. And by the way, guys, I would use straw for mulch rather than hay. Hay tends to have weed seeds in it, and you don't want to be adding that to your garden bed. So definitely straw is a better option. And, will work better for your garden beds as far as that goes. Bruce, how you doing, Bruce? Great to see you here today. Bruce says, how large does a Tiny Tim fruit get? I have ripening fruit about a half an inch in diameter on an indoor plant that is fed at least weekly with hydroponic fertilizer. Okay, great question, Bruce. They generally do get about a half inch in diameter. I've had a few that can get a little bit larger than that, some that get smaller than that, depending on where you have them growing, how much sunlight you get. If you're growing them indoors, they may not get quite as large, or you may not get quite as many. But then again, growing them hydroponically could kind of balance those out with the fertilizer that you're using for that. So, but you're right on track there. So definitely let us know how things turn out for you. I know you've also been planting some outdoors in your garden as well. So it'd be kind of fun to see the comparison from one to the other. Okay, let me take a question from Instagram. There are actually quite a few questions on Instagram this morning. I posted, we were doing a live Q&A, and a lot of you were able to pop over there and put a question on. And the first one here is from 808 Ladybug. So she's usually here on the live streams. Hopefully she's here today. And 808 Ladybug has had some difficulty over the past getting zucchini to flower and then harvest. So she's finally got one on, which is super exciting. And she says, when is the best time to harvest? I've seen them in the market rather small, yet I've also seen them picked by gardeners and they're larger. This is the first time I've got one, so I want to make sure I harvest at the right time. And 808, I would say there's no set time to harvest. It's really your preference. Yes, the ones in the market are quite small. I would probably go a little bit larger than that. You know, it's probably, those are maybe 4 to 6 inches long. I myself would probably try and pick them about 8 to 10 inches long. It does depend on the variety that you're growing. The Black Beauty eggplant, which is in my, the Black Beauty zucchini, it's in my squash seed collection, can grow huge, like baseball bat size, but it's not the best eating. So I would say 8 to 10 inches long. And then pick one and see if that's your preference. If you like them a little bit larger and they're not getting as seedy, once they get larger, you can go ahead and go with that. I don't mind the seediness at all. So I do tend to grow mine a little larger. We slice it for zucchini lasagna or to throw on the grill. Or if they're really large, I'll, you know, shred them up, remove the seeds and shred them up and make baked goods like zucchini bread or that type of thing with them, or zucchini boats are always good too. So I'm really excited for you though. I know you've been trying to get a zucchini for quite a while, so you definitely have to keep us posted. Let us know how it goes with that one. Okay, Jan, really looking forward to having you be able to have your own zucchini. Okay, questions here in the chat. This is really fun to just take questions and answers and just kind of hang out and talk gardening together. And I know if I'm not able to get to all the questions, Cliff and Nisha will answer as many as they're able to while things are flying by in the chat. Here's a great question from Dawn Starr. How you doing, Dawn? Thank you so much for joining us today. And Dawn says, can I use the same dirt to replant different lettuce? Yes, you absolutely can. Soil is one of the largest investments, biggest investments you're going to make in your garden. You never want to get rid of it. You never want to throw it away. I've been reusing soil for years. And the really important thing to do when you're reusing soil is always add some fresh nutrients. You could fill your container if you're growing in containers, maybe 3/4 full with the old soil, and then add some fresh soil or fresh nutrients. You could use compost, you could use worm castings, fresh potting mix, and then kind of make sure that the soil is nice and moist, mix it into your old soil, and you've got fresh nutrients to replant your lettuce. So absolutely, you can do the same in your raised beds, your garden beds, any of your containers that you have, always add those fresh nutrients and you will be good to go, all right? So let us know how it goes with your lettuce. I'm sure it's gonna thrive and do absolutely wonderful. And thanks so much for your question. Okay, let's see what other kinds of questions we have in the chat here today. And I think there were a couple of questions on the walls of water there. And mine are doing really well. The only issue I've had with them has been because things have been so moist, I have a lot more bugs than usual this year. So some of the peppers inside of the walls of water are getting a little bit chowed down, and I just haven't had a chance to get out there and take a look at them and apply some bug solutions. But other than that, they're keeping warm. The tomatoes I have in the walls of water are definitely surviving. One of them is actually blooming. So it definitely has helped us here on our end to get some plants in the garden that we wouldn't normally be able to quite get planted yet this year. Okay, question. Speaking of soil, our next question actually is on seed starting mix and soil. So let me read that one here from Iris. And Iris says, thank you for sharing your knowledge. I have a question. I just planted my seeds but I have quite a bit of leftover of the soilless seed starting mix. How dry must it be to store for 2 weeks? Okay, I have a DIY recipe for a soilless seed starting mix in the Grow Your Groceries series. So if you're not sure about how to get your seed started, make that because it saves you a ton of money. Seed starting mix from the garden center is very, very expensive, and you can make your own for a lot less. It has worm castings, vermiculite, and coca core, and it does help cut down on some of the fungus gnats. And I do recommend letting it dry out before you store it, like in a closed type of bin. You don't have to use it right away. There's no expiration date. But what I do with mine is I make it in a big storage tub, so I always have some whenever I need to pot stuff up or start seeds. And then I just kind of leave the lid ajar a little bit on my shelf in the garage. And that way it gives air circulation, it dries out. I really don't put the lid completely on unless it's totally dry because I don't want, you know, mold growing in it or anything like that. So I would definitely recommend letting it dry out before you store it. But it's indefinite, has no expiration date. And when I have, when I take them in little containers outside and pot them up, if I have extra seed starting mix, I have another container that I use and just dump the extra in outdoors. Maybe like a couple of my plants got some fungus gnats and things like that. Took it outside, dumped it in another bin, and then that seed starting mix I'll continue to reuse over and over again, adding nutrients. You can put it in your smart pots containers outdoors. Also check out the DIY potting mix recipe, which has larger chunks of like compost and things like that. And you can really use either one in your outdoor containers. But the seed starting mix works great for starting seeds indoors because it's nice and fine. And that way the seeds don't have difficulty germinating because the mix is such a nice fine mix for them. Okay, and I have another question here on soil from Debbie, and this is a very common problem that a lot of gardeners have that you might not have expected when you're buying bagged mix from the garden center. And Debbie says, I'm new to gardening. I want to try and grow some tomatoes, but I've been reading about people buying potting soil and finding a soil to be wet and full of gnats. How can I avoid this, and what kind of soil is good for me to use on my raised bed? Okay, great way to avoid this is once you bring your potting mix home, there's really no way to tell if there's actually fungus gnats or fungus gnat eggs in the soil unless you open it up and, you know, you just see a ton of them. But you can very easily sterilize your soil just by pouring boiling water over it. So you can either dump your soil, your bag of soil, into a wheelbarrow or something that has drainage. If it's dry soil, just dump it into the wheelbarrow, pour boiling water over it, mix it around. And then that boiling water will kill the eggs or the fungus gnats that might be living in it. And then you won't have an issue with that anymore with your potting mix. You could also just cut open the bag of potting mix and then wet it with the boiling water in the bag and go that way. And then wait till it kind of cools off before you plant your seeds. And that way you'll be all set as far as those pesky little fungus gnats go. As far as soil for raised beds, go back and watch our video series from last year on raised bed gardening. We did. We filled a whole raised bed with a DIY soil mix. Very easy to do. It's going to save you a ton of money. And also my book on raised bed gardening has 3 or 4 different soil mixes in it. Depending on the supplies that you can find where you live, you could also purchase a soil in bulk. A lot of local landscape companies, if you have a truck or access to a truck, or their delivery, they will deliver, their delivery fees aren't too high, you can grab some organic soil from your local landscape company, and it's going to save you a lot of money over the bagged raised bed soil at the garden centers. So you always want to look for ways you can cut costs in the garden. We're all about keeping things quick, simple, inexpensive, and of course, fun. So hopefully that will help, Debbie, and I really appreciate your question. Let me grab a question here, another question from Instagram, and then we'll head back to the chat. There's lots of questions flying back and forth. Really fun to see all the excitement for gardening here in the springtime. Okay, here is a question from My City Huerto, which I believe is here in the chat today. And which vegetable plants are the most sensitive to wind and how to protect them against high winds once in the ground or potted up permanently? Okay, great question. My reel this morning on Instagram talked about a lot of people are afraid to get their transplants, like start hearting them off on a windy day like today. But if you saw my reel, you saw that I said it's actually really good for the transplants. Not a huge stormy gale, but if you can put them out there when they get the breezes, what's going to happen is it's going to make them stronger plants. They really need that wind in order for their stems to be stronger, for them to develop their muscles almost, so that once you do get them planted out in the garden permanently, they're going to be strong, sturdy, stocky plants and able to stand up to the elements. So that being said, I did caution people, make sure that you do always harden off and do this process gradually. You wouldn't want to put them outside all day on a super windy day without checking on them. And then gradually increasing the amount of time they're outside. I did leave my plants out there for a couple hours this morning and then brought them in just to give their muscles a little bit of a workout. So definitely the plants that are a little bit more susceptible are smaller seedlings, or I'd say probably vining vegetables that you might already have tied to a trellis planted outside. They're getting the brunt of the wind being up high. What I do, now it's impossible for me to do this to all of my garden, but if there's a couple of plants that I really want to protect from the wind, a lot of times what I'll do is wrap that container or that garden bed in shade cloth. It still allows the wind and the sunlight to get through. It's not a plastic type of tarp that will, you know, burn your plants underneath, but it does give them some protection. So if you can do that, if you have access to shade cloth, you already have some on these windy days like that, you might want to try that for some of your taller plants that you're a little bit concerned about. The peppers do tend to have a little bit of a weaker stem that might snap in the wind. Cucumbers, again, trellised, watermelon trellised up high, may be a little bit more susceptible to that. So just check that out. And hopefully that helps you out there. Okay. So always come back and let us know how things go. If we make a suggestion, it didn't work for you. And always be willing to experiment and try new things. And then come back to the chat and let us know how things worked out for you. Okay, V says, my seedlings were yelling at me, Mom, take us in. The wind is definitely too strong. So yeah, always keep an eye, right? Keep a little weather eye on your plants out there. And if they do show like they're wilting, signs of stress, go ahead and bring them in. And I know Jack on Instagram made a really great comment there and really great job on that, Jack. I appreciate you sharing that. You do want to make sure that your plants are well watered on a windy day, because even a day like today where it's still pretty chilly outside, the wind really, really dries out the leaves and dries out the soil a lot quicker. So do make sure you check on your plants for that as well. Okay, let's see here. Gardener Tom, always love Gardener Tom's comments. He's a master gardener and offers lots of garden expertise. And Gardener Tom says, I use 6 parts water to 1 part, 3% hydrogen peroxide to the boiling water before I put in my seed starting mix. Really helps with the fungus gnats. So great suggestion there, Gardener Tom. Love hearing all your wonderful tips here in the chat. Rocky USA, welcome. I just started my pepper seeds today. So super exciting. And hopefully you're counting back from your frost date and are able to get some of your seeds started. Great job on that. If you haven't yet, check out what seeds you can start in your area. Maybe you're past your frost date, but right now is a really good time in California to get the cucumber, all the seeds that kind of grow fast, the cucumbers, the beans, the melons. I actually started some way too early and they bit the dust. So we're restarting all of those for hopefully being put out in the garden in about 3 to 4 weeks. If you're in some of the northern climates, you might just be getting your tomatoes and peppers, some of your longer growing vegetables started. We've got all the info for you in our Grow Your Groceries with CaliKim series. So go back and watch that. And over the next few weeks, we're going to be moving some of these plants out in the garden and really going strong with our spring garden and going for all those vegetables because we're super, super excited. Okay, here's a question from Aussie Agogo. How long should new soil bake before adding plants? That's kind of a preference thing. I know if you can add compost and amendments maybe a month or so before you pop in your seedlings, that's always good because as Cliff actually mentioned when he was here filming a video, it's nice to have the microbes and everything kind of start to cook a little bit and not necessarily that your soil will get really hot, but just gives those microbes time to work and make the soil nice and fertile. However, we don't always have the luxury of time. So even if you just add compost, add amendments, and plant right away, that's perfectly okay. Either way, you're going to be able to grow your veggies. But if you can add your compost a little bit earlier than that, then it'll just kind of get things cooking away a little bit sooner. Okay, back into the questions here from the YouTube videos. And this one was from Amara. And Amara's question was regarding how many containers or pots does she need for her spring garden? And she says, I feel like I get overwhelmed about how many pots I need and what kinds of plants I can and can't grow together. And her second question was, do I always need mulch or only in the summer? So great, great questions. I'm sure a lot of us have wondered that at one point or another. As far as how many pots, I really encourage you to start simple. If you're feeling overwhelmed, maybe you're trying to bite off a little bit more than you're ready to handle at this point. Or, you know, maybe you just don't have the time to deal with that many containers. So even if you just start with one container, if you want to grow more, start with 3 to 5 containers. But my advice is always when you're starting out, start simple and expand later. So pick 3 to 5 vegetables that you would like to grow. Plant those in containers, in 3 to 5 containers. And then as far as what vegetables you can and can't plant together, I would always try and plant vegetables with similar growing needs together. And you want to plant cool weather vegetables with cool weather vegetables, warm weather vegetables with warm weather vegetables. And that way, you know, you're going to have much more chance of success because they're growing together in like growing conditions. So I have a whole chart in the back of my book on raised bed gardening that details out, I've done the heavy lifting for you, what plants are cool weather vegetables, what plants are warm weather vegetables, when you can start them from seed indoors, and when you can plant them outside. So no need to wonder, no need to worry. Just you can head over and pick that up at CaliKimGardeningHome.com, my book on raised bed gardening. Now, one thing you might want to consider too, if you're growing tomatoes or a larger vegetable, is grow a smaller cool weather vegetable kind of around the base of it that can kind of provide some shade. The tomato could provide some shade for some greens underneath. So that way you can kind of grow different types of vegetables together. But as a general rule, you want to grow cool weather with cool weather and warm weather with warm weather. And hopefully that'll take a lot of the guesswork out of it for you and help you get started on a smaller scale so you don't feel overwhelmed. And then maybe next time you can expand into additional containers. And her second question was about mulch. Do you always need mulch or just in the summertime? I like to use mulch all throughout the year for so many different reasons. In the summer, it does help with the water retention when things really heat up, especially in containers. But in the winter, I also enjoy using it because it insulates the plants from the cold and it brings in the worms. So I really like using shredded leaves whenever I can. That's a huge, huge benefit for worms. It's a free resource. Right now, shredded leaves might be a little bit in short supply unless you've been collecting them. But in the fall, make sure you collect those leaves and even go around to your neighbors and ask if they have any they're not using for their garden or maybe they don't have a garden. And that way you always have a supply. In fact, I've got a big old compost sack on the side of my house that's full of leaves that we've been collecting all throughout the wintertime. So definitely never get rid of your leaves. So great question. Thank you so much, Amara. I really appreciate you asking that on YouTube, and hopefully that helps. Okay, let's hear in the chat what other questions we have going on here. And here's a question from Rachel. How you doing, Rachel? Great to have you here today. Hi, Kim. I'm in Long Island, New York, Zone 7. I first used fabric pots in 2021 for my patio container garden. When I discovered your videos, my harvest was epic. But how do I stop squirrels from digging in my pots? Okay, I think the squirrel question is one of the biggest ones I get from gardeners all over the place. So let me know in the chat if you have issues with squirrels. In fact, I actually was on an NPR radio show on Friday, did a live call-in show, and we probably had 3 or 4 questions on squirrels. So I know it's a huge issue for a lot of you. A couple of different things I do with squirrels. Number one, if you've got a couple of your pots or your smart pots, you may want to consider netting them in like a tool type of fabric. I just did a couple reels and videos on that, so you can check out that content over on our YouTube channel or on our Instagram or on my Instagram at CaliKim. So the tulle fabric is a netting type of fabric, tiny little holes. It's actually used under wedding dresses and that type of thing. You can buy it in different colors, so it's kind of pretty. It's super inexpensive at craft stores. A really great way to protect your plants from squirrels and bunnies. So I would highly suggest that. In the summertime, shade cloth works well. But I've also had a lot of success with the Repels All by Bonide. Comes in granules and in a spray. The reason why I like it doesn't harm the animals, but it's got like a clove and a garlic oil, has a nice strong odor to it. So you can sprinkle the granules around your pots, it really helps, or you can spray the outside of your pots with the spray. So you can find that over on Bonide. They don't actually sell the product on their website, but you can take a look at the product and then head to Amazon or at your local garden center. It's people and pet safe when it's used as directed, and it's worked really, really well for us. You will need to reapply it on a regular basis, like when you're getting heavy rains. But with a two-pronged approach, hopefully at least you'll keep some of the squirrels at bay and keep them from eating all of your crops. So I know, I totally hear you. It's a really tough issue for a lot of us gardeners because they're super, super aggressive. Okay, Lori Malone, a question about cow pots. I'm using lettuce seedlings in cow pots, but they dry out quickly. I covered with plastic, but no signs of growth. It's been 5 to 6 days. Okay, lettuce seedlings. Lori, give it some time, okay? Give it some time. Really depends on the temperature in your house. You want to make sure it's not too hot. Lettuce will germinate well in like 60 to 75 degree temps. Colder than that, it's going to take a little bit longer. And the cow pots drying out actually is a really good problem to have because it gives you a clue as when to water them. So if they're wet like this, you don't need to water. But if they're dry, and I just watered a lot of mine this morning, so they're all pretty wet. If the cow pots look dry, then you definitely do need to water. But the huge advantage of these is that they break down. So it really saves you time on your seed starting. But when you're germinating, it's super important that you do keep them wet. So I pretty much keep the top of the soil wet. So I will spray the top of my soil with a spray bottle almost every day, sometimes twice a day. Those lettuce seedlings are either not covered or barely covered. So you really have to keep the top of the soil dry. It is going to dry out quickly. And I think you're going to see a really big difference if you really pay attention to making sure the top stays nice and wet. And I'm really loving these because they break down a lot quicker than some of the other pots out there on the market. They're made from cow manure. They're actually in, you're going to get four little pots when you purchase one of my subscription boxes. I have four in here, plus the seeds, plus the soil, everything you need for your garden project. So give that a try, Lori, and hopefully that'll help. Really pay attention to the watering. Super important when you're germinating your seeds from scratch there, okay, when you're first starting out. Okay, let me see. Actually, well, let's do another Instagram question, all right? We will take a look at that. Let me pull up my Instagram here. And let's see here. I think Terry, she's here today. Let me answer her question. So she's wondering about the wind. It might also be helpful for pollination. Yes, it definitely is, as long as it's not too terribly windy and your plants are blowing over. But yes, it definitely will help pollinate. And Terry's question is about her tomato plants. Her tiny Tim has so many little leaves low on the stems. Should I pinch those off, put soil around them, or just leave them alone? You know what, Terry? I would just leave them alone. Tiny Tims are what's called determinant tomatoes. So you really don't want to trim or prune determinant tomatoes too much. So determinant tomato, it's usually a smaller plant, grows to a determined or a set size. Tiny Tims are about 2 feet or so tall. And then they're going to produce their crop and the plant will die. It's just kind of how the plant genetics works. However, Tiny Tims will produce for several months, as long as you keep any yellowing or brown leaves trimmed. So that's when I would trim the leaves. But as far as small leaves on the bottom, I wouldn't worry about that too much. You want them to grow nice and leafy, nice and strong. So just let them grow. And I would, though, pinch off any flowers until they get to maybe a foot or so high. Let them get nice and leafy, nice and strong, and then, you know, you can let them start flowering and producing fruit. So thanks, Terry, and you're gonna have to come back and let us know how your Tiny Tims turn out. I know you're gonna absolutely love them. So let's answer some more questions that are here in the chat. Let me see if I have any more from the YouTube videos. I know there's lots here in the chat, so we'll scroll through and get as many of those as we can before the live stream ends. And hopefully we're all about just helping you grow as many groceries as you can here as spring approaches, right? Okay, let me scroll through here. And Throne Logic, thank you so much for a super chat, $5. Early springtime, keep young seedlings wet and slowly harden off outside for big cucumbers. So great advice there. Monitoring the water can always be just a little bit tricky, but I feel like that's really one of the most important things you can do with your seedlings is watering and feeding them, especially if, like myself, they're inside for longer than they normally are at this time of the year. So do watch our watering and fertilizing your indoor seedlings video from the Grow Your Grocery series. Lots more details in there. I always love fertilizing with the Vermicera Vitality. This is really my go-to. I found helps struggling seedlings. It's like a supercharged worm casting drink there for your plants. So absolutely loving this. My plants get fed with it once a week. And by the way, you guys, for the second month, Vermicera and myself are gifting this to you in the Grow Your Grocery subscription box. So it's a free little bonus with your purchase. This is a $14.99 value. It's an 8-ounce bottle. We just want to say thanks for gardening with us. And I absolutely love Vermicera Vitality. I know you're going to love it too. So make sure you do grab your April box because this is probably the last month we'll be offering this for free in the box. And I know you're going to love it as well. Okay, let's see what other questions are flying by here in the chat. Let's see here. Why does the super chat look dirty? Okay, that's funny. Yeah, you are going to get a second bottle, Lori. It's going to be amazing. I know you're going to love it. It is just a wonderful organic fertilizer for your plants there. So do make sure you go over and check out Vermicera's Instagram as well. Give them a follow. Show them some love. Let them know how much you enjoyed your Vitality that was free in the first box, and then we're continuing on to the second. Let them know how much you love that. I know they will appreciate it. Rory, great question. What is the difference between Vitality and worm castings? Worm castings are a dry soil amendment that you can add right to your garden beds. It tends to feed your plants. It's like a time release. It feeds your plants over a long period of time. So I always add those to, that's why I add it to my seed starting mix, to my potting mix, to my garden beds, because it really just supercharges the soil, adds aeration, also brings more worms in as well. The Vitality is actually made from worm casting, so it's a liquid form, and it's immediately available to your plants. It has a natural root hormone in it, so that's one reason why it works so well for seedlings. People ask me all the time, why do your seedlings look so good? It's because I use this on it, and they just grow strong, healthy, green. It especially is good for struggling plants. So if you've got some seedlings that maybe aren't looking so good, I've done this so many times, use this on them. It's a concentrate. So I just put a few squirts in the bottom of my seedling tray, fill it with water, gives it a nice little drink, and it really does help revitalize them. So love this stuff. It's really the key to my healthy seedlings. Okay, and you can head over to vermicera.com and you can get 10% off with the code CaliKim if you want to grab a bottle for yourself or get a free bottle in our sub box for April. Okay, you got it, Rory, no problem. And yeah, the Vitality makes a huge, huge difference, and I know you're going to love it. Okay, let me scroll through, see if we have any comments or questions we didn't catch earlier. And then we may go ahead and sign off here. Till next week, do make sure you stay tuned. We'll have a couple videos this week and back again on Monday, next Monday at noon Pacific time for our weekly live stream. Make sure you set a reminder on your calendar. Join us for that. We'd love to have you. Invite your friends and let's just kick off spring gardening together here. Okay, let me just scroll up here and see if we have any last questions. Okay, here's a great question from Cordy Culture. Have you ever used old coffee grounds to make a homemade fertilizer with spent coffee grounds? Been sitting for weeks wondering about adding banana peels. Okay, you know what is a great thing to do with your coffee grounds? I haven't made an actual fertilizer out of coffee grounds themselves. Sometimes I will just kind of pour my used coffee out on my plants or sprinkle the coffee grounds, the used coffee grounds around the plants. But what I love to do is add them to the compost. We do have a brand new compost video we'll be shooting hopefully this week if we don't get too much rain in the brand new mini Smart Pots compost sack. So it's a great smaller size for a patio or for a balcony garden. And we're gonna be putting coffee grounds in that because coffee grounds can really heat your compost up quickly, a new brand new pile, and make it break down faster. So you have free fertilizer for your garden. So be watching for that. And if you're interested in that Smart Pots compost sack, head over to smartpots.com. They've got it now live on there. I know a lot of you have been looking for that and asking about that for a lot of for quite a long time. Angela, great suggestion. Use coffee grounds in my soil. Great idea, adding aeration and just kind of adding that little extra boost to your soil. So what a fun live stream today. Over 162 people here. Thank you so much for joining us. And I'm really glad that we can kick off our spring gardening season together. We'll be back again next week. Don't forget to use the code APRILSUBBOX for $5 off our new April subscription box for this month. And visit us over on YouTube. Pop comments on our YouTube videos. We read and answer as many comments as we possibly can in our Instagrams as well. I'm CaliKim and CameraGuy. Come on up, camera guy. Is Kelly camera guy? Yes. He always has tons of fun behind the scenes on his Instagram as well.
So yes, thanks for that. Yep, hope you all enjoy that. And we'll be putting up some more critter content here in the next couple days.
Oh, yeah. We're getting lots of good critters outside. Keep an eye on those. Yep. So watch for camera guy's critter cam. All right, everyone. Have a great week. And we'll see you on next week's live stream and a few videos in between. Bye-bye.
Bye.